Welcome to the finance meeting on July the 9th, 2019. We have approval of the agenda.
It's moved by Councillor Casey Owens, seconded by Councillor Dennis Perrier. The council approves the agenda for the meeting of finance held July 9th, 2019 as presented.
All in favor? Unanimous? Declaration of pecuniary interest, is there any? None seen, none noted. Reports of municipal officers communications. I guess you're doing that, Wolf?
I suppose
you and
I
Sherry are sharing, and Peter, I guess.
Yes. Okay. Yes, it would be myself, Treasurer Sherry Matthews, and Deputy Treasurer Peter Georgioff. What we plan to do is, you have the documents before you. We're, for the purposes of the audience, to provide a summary of the main discussion points. Obviously, there will be more to it than that, and as people ask for questions and that, we will put up and refer to the documents as necessary. For the benefit of the public, I thought I would stay with the same kind of presentation as we had done in the past in order to provide some of the definitions, assumptions, and challenges that set the tone for the budget deliberations in 2019. First, we go through some of the definitions, so some of these terms do not seem too outlandish. We'll recap the challenges and the guiding premises. We'll introduce the combined preliminary budgets. Again, I'm just doing the summary of the main points. And we'll do with some, Sherry will take you through any kind of questions regarding to expenditures, revenues, net, et cetera, and then the options. For definitions, operating budget, that's your day-to-day stuff. It's your expenditures and revenues associated with the provision of services. We usually calculate them by corporate departments and regional agencies, but we summarize them as per the FIR reporting standards. That's new for us, something that we've only begun today, or sorry, this year, but we believe that it's the way we should go, so that it makes it easier for the public and council to compare Kirkland Lake to other municipalities as per the reporting. Capital budget are those significant expenditures to acquire, construct, improve land, buildings, engineering structures, machinery, equipment, etc. Things that last a little bit longer, do a little bit more. This budget will set out the anticipated capital expenditures as well as how they are to be financed. There's not one pot of money, there's multiple ones. Water and wastewater budgets, these are distinct and separate budgets. They cover the costs associated with the treatment, distribution, collection, and again, treatment of the waste services. We do have, in 2016, I believe it was, the budgets were allocated separately, and a rate study guided the municipality on what the percentage increases would be. The rate in Kirkland Lake, the water rates are levied as a flat rate for residences based on number of rooms, and a metered rate for commercial and industrial properties. The wastewater rate is set at a percentage of the water rate per property, at this point 80%. Reserves, think of them as a promise. They're part of an accumulative surplus that are allocated at the discretion of council. It's a commitment. There are no separate funds are being set aside. Reserve funds, on the other hand, are more like a bank account. They are segregated and they are very restricted. You can only use them for specific purposes. This will come into play when we talk especially about the water, the wastewater, and then some of council's aspirations in terms of establishing reserve funds for future financial stability. What were the challenges? We have an aging community, and that's reflected in our infrastructure. Point of comparison, when you look at Government Road as you go up Beaver Hill, that's your water line feeding the west end of your municipality, and it's 70 some years old. Underinvestment, especially in equipment and infrastructure. We simply haven't kept up with the demands of the corporation working in the 20th and 21st century. There's been a historic lack of long-term planning, especially infrastructure and financial planning. By that I refer to specifically a lack of reserve funds set aside to manage issues that arise perhaps expectedly, perhaps unexpectedly. In fact, I think you could say that expecting the unexpected is expected in Kirkland Lake. It was hard to say. Late passing of the 2018 budget did result in capital projects being delayed to 2019. That was brought forward as part of the finance discussions and identified. operational challenges. We've struggled with the underlying logic of the budget and finance as it has been established for Kirkland Lake, and Sherry has done, I think, a fantastic job of reorienting that to make it more more understandable, more accessible, and more measurable in the future. We've also had staff changes, vacancies, and need for training. These were issues that we have faced as challenges. What were the premises for the 2019 budget? Again, we're staff. We tell you what you need to hear, not what you may want to hear. We recommend you decide. Whatever you decide, there's no right or wrong, we will implement. Council did tell us don't build on your past mistakes. Rationalize the budget now so we have a firm foundation to build on in the future. No guessing. We want to get away from the guessing component. We want to get away from reinventing the wheel every time we come forward. We really would like to take this as a starting point for long-term financial planning so people can see what is coming up, what the issues may be down the road, and what they may cost. You also told us to be fiscally responsible. Our assumptions and projections must reflect reality, do not distort the reality. I would love to tell you that that particular bridge is only going to cost you $100,000 when perhaps it's $2 million. I don't do that. I'm a taxpayer here too, as all my colleagues, and we bear the brunt of that as well. You also told us don't be frivolous. Come up with what is needed for the place to run and to get back on a firm footing operationally and financially. We've tried to do that. You've told us anticipate the big problems ahead and try to plan accordingly with some of our recommendations that is reflected in that. We thought that we would start with the reserve and the reserve funds first, just what the summaries are, the details, and that was as part of your package. The reason we're starting with that is it gives you an idea. What are you starting with? Where's your money? What pocket is it in? And what can you do with it? The summary would be that the total proposed reserve balance at the end of 2019 should be $3,018,777. The total proposed reserve fund balance at 12/19, $1 million. I'm going to stop at this point and let Sherry speak to that as to any illumination on that.
I don't want to get all lost in the numbers because I know some people find it confusing, but all we did want to mention was that you can tie all of these transfers to the rest of the documents, because what we wanted everybody to understand is, you know, your operating budget, your capital budget, your water, enter wastewater, they all tie together. So, like I say, you should be able to tie those movements between all of those budgets. The other thing we wanted to mention is at the last meeting we were asked to do some options with respect to putting money away for reserve and reserve funds. So just quickly, I wanted to just run through and mention some of those. So one of them was a tax rate stabilization reserve. So the idea behind that one would be that you wanted to fund tax revenue shortfalls, unforeseen one-time expenditures, MPAC appeals, an offset to increases in taxes. So the whole idea being moving forward, say we end up in the same position and you're looking at a tax increase, you would have something you could draw down from to make that hit not as large to whichever class. The other one that was mentioned was the winter control reserve. So there again, you would mitigate the impacts of a heavy snowfall winter, and it wouldn't be such a big impact to that operating budget. As we all know, Mother Nature kind of hit us last year, so the operating budget is going to have to reflect that. But if you had a reserve fund or a reserve for money put away for that, once again, it wouldn't be such a big hit. You could draw that down. And the other big ones that we had talked about were they would be more of a reserve fund in terms of, say, if it was a fire department and you needed a pumper truck, we'd start to put money away for that, or just one as generic as calling it a life cycle replacement or a capital infrastructure reinvestment reserve fund. So there again, start to put the money away because you know you're going to have these expenditures in the future. The money's there, it's not as big a hit in the year that you actually need that kind of what Will was mentioning, expect the unexpected.
Okay. Sorry. So to recap, council gave us direction that they want to have a better plan, better footing for their future. These were some of the reserve and reserve funds that we're bringing forward as for your consideration to establish now. It will be difficult because nobody gives you money to put into there. It's coming from us, but it will lessen the blow of adverse events such as we did have with the winter of last year. And it will make the municipality stronger as it moves forward to say something else should occur. I'm going to move on. The water and wastewater budget summary. So again, the sheets that refer to are printed up above. To summarize, water expenditures were up 0.54% over 2018. What we need to raise from user fees, 2.4, almost 2.5 million. That includes 150,000 being put aside for future projects. Wastewater expenditures are up 10.6 over 2018. When you consider that every time you touch a road, there's a pipe underneath it, and more than likely, it's probably going to be a sewer pipe. That makes a lot of sense. To be raised from user fees, 1.7 million, includes 59,000 for the future. I'll turn it back to Sharon.
Okay. So from our last meeting on July the 2nd, we tried to see if we could come up with a better allocation between the water and the sewer. As Wolf mentioned, my understanding is this came about in 2017 where the sewer came off the tax bill and it went into its own fund, similar to the water. As to how they arrived at the allocations and the setup, I don't know that. But what we tried to do is we put it back to the basics. So if we know that our staff, they fill out timesheets, and on those timesheets, they indicate whether or not they're working in a water project or a sewer project, that to me is the best indication as to how we should be splitting it. So that's what we've done, is we've gone back and we've made sure that anything that wasn't already split that way, so whether it be all our vehicles, they were always in the water fund, which seems unreasonable. Obviously, they're using those same vehicles to do sewer projects. So that's how we managed to get down from the 22% to the 18% as an increase in the water, basically trying to allocate it on a more reasonable basis. That being said, and I believe Wolf has already mentioned, like there was a rate study done previously, but I would be inclined to believe that it probably should be done again. Partly for that reason, what should the allocation be? The other thing being, what should the rates actually be to make sure that it's sustainable, both water and sewer? The other thing being, I believe rate studies will tell you what your rates should be in order for you to also put money away for the future. Because the issue being the increase of 18% for proposed increase of 18% for 2019, in large part is because we've got capital projects of over, I think it's 400 and some thousand, you're gonna have to fund that with this year's user fees because there's no reserve fund left. That's the problem. I mean, I did a quick thing from 2012 to 2018 as to what was in the Waterworks Reserve Fund. Well, the lowest point was 2015 where it was $121,000. The highest point was in 2016, you had 277,000. You ended 2018 with $49,000, and most of that is already spoken for in 2018 projects that didn't get completed. So there's nothing. So that's why it's 18%, because you need to fund this year's capital projects for water. I don't focus as much on the sewer only for the fact that the way it was set up in 2017, the sewer rates are a function of, or a percentage of, what the water is. Now, in the working paper, in the spreadsheets we've provided, we've put 80% and 75%. 80% was how it initially started. 75%, the only reason I did that is because last year, that was what they went down to. They went to actually 74.25%, which I have no idea why. Because the structure in the first report I saw to council for last year, it was supposed to still manage to be 80%. And for whatever reason, it went and it ended up at 74, so I don't know. But like I say, that's the idea. 18%, it's a big number. We all agree with that. But that's why, is because to fund the capital.
It's not to say the rate study that was provided was wrong. Probably wasn't. But we fell off the wagon somewhere along the line. And one year, The normal staff that would participate in did not participate in that planning, and you had increases that were out of line with what the rate study said. You didn't follow it. I think the other major issue would be that other things, life happens. Some projects that you perhaps were identified in the rate study, I'm not citing a specific example, but a project or a potential project that you think would be 5 or 10 years down the road, something went wrong and it happened right away. An example of that as actual, Beaver Drive, the gate valves controlling the flow of water to the water tower, seized, broke, and basically we had to declare an emergency because we could not get water, we could not replenish the tower. We were able to do the job in 2 days, but there's $110,000 gone that you were not anticipating at that time. That's the kind of job that you try to find funding for, if you can, and you know, do it that way. But you can't take any chances, you can't postpone it. You have to deal with it. I'm going to move on. Operating in the capital budget summary, I'll turn it over to Sherry for the reference sheets. The summary aspect of it, expenses were up 7.89 from 2018 actuals. The net difference to 2018 actuals was 1.9. Big ticket items that caused this, and that's what Sherry will be talking about, the winter maintenance, excuse me, the pool loan, OPP, salaries. When I say council, I'm not pointing at individuals, I'm talking about the legal regime that has changed with integrity commissioner, et cetera. Capital, total is 4.8, almost 4.9. Total government funding, 2.5. Total to be raised from the levy, 463. The remainder comes from the water, wastewater reserves, reserve funds. So the total amount to be raised from the levy for operating and capital, 2019, 10.896. Sorry if there's a typo in there. You're taking out half of the surplus that came back over from 2018 to bring the amount down to 10.66677. In comparison, 2018, the amount raised from the levy was 10 million. I refer to Sherry.
Okay, so we were we figured the best way was trying to rationalize why are we asking, why does the levy need to be almost 10.9 million this year compared to 10 million last year? So what I tried to do is I started with what the ask was last year, which was just over 10 million, but we also know that there was like a $436,000 surplus, so I've taken that out. So you're left with the almost the 9.6. So in the space of a few minutes, it was very easy to come up with some big numbers that are different to account for why the ask this year is almost 10.9. So you've got your OPP contract. There's no negotiation on that. It's a commitment. I mean, you have an agreement with the OPP. As far as salaries and benefits, you have union contracts. There's percentages that are already set in those contracts. I've just used the 1.75 as an average. As far as winter maintenance, we've already discussed that. The winter that we had, that's reflected in the 2019 budget. There's no way around that. That's already happened. As far as mayor and council, Wilf mentioned there's a new legislative requirement for the integrity commissioner. So and that's a budget number that was come up with, but it still could be used. As far as the Kale Gold loan, there again, that's a commitment. There is no, you can't get around that. It related to a 2018 capital project that we had a loan with Kale Gold for. As far as the pool loan, there again, last year you only had 3 payments. This year you have 12. Now the Heritage North is going the other way. Last year it was 12 payments. This year the loan is done in June. So just on a very quick math, you can see that that's how we get to 10.9. Now I do realize, yes, there's always going to be pluses and minuses in a budget, and I'm sure there's tons of them. But the thing is, these are big ticket items that you can't control, and that's how you get to your 10.9.
I'm not touching that, I'm moving on. I said at the beginning that we tell you what we think you need to hear, not what you necessarily want to hear. When we looked at it and we said, what do we have to do to keep the good ship Lollipop afloat? city levy, proposing 4 to 6% increase applied with the additional amount applied to reserve and or reserve funds as per council stated preference. Use $218,000 of the 2018 surplus to reduce that levy burden. Water, 18% increase, down from the previous projection of 22%, adding 150 to the future. Wastewater, make sure it is 80% of your established water rate, put some into the reserve. Two contentious, potentially contentious items. We had a discussion at council about the SCADA upgrades at the water plant. Now, water plant is 40 years old, SCADA there is, I think, 35. You're paying $110,000 towards that project in 2019. In 2020, you know the remainder has to be done. So we did get a one-time additional funding of gas tax. I'm proposing that you put $325,000 of that aside to recover those remaining SCADA project costs and therefore lower the hit to your water budget in the, 2020. Also from the gas tax, take $500,000 of that and bank it to serve as a rainy day fund. Why? Main reason is you're only you only got 6 months left of the year. It compensates for our lack of reserves and reserve funds at present. It provides a cushion in case of an emergency. We talked about the sanitary stormwater tunnel, say a fire department, anything. And then in the future, it could be used to reduce future borrowing. We don't we do know that say for a Swastika project, the if OSIF funding is reduced, we will have to borrow the difference. So I'm a very conservative person, and I get scared easily, especially when there's numbers involved, as my wife will tell you. I like to always think that there's a cushion, and I can see, I'm also a cynical person, I can see that you have some big risks that could take you down. I don't want to be taken down in one shot, so I'm suggesting, like I say, the $500,000 to be kept as a rainy day fund. You can bank it. It's not eligible, you can't use it for everything, but it's pretty broad. And then you have it still for next year. It's not like it's taken away. That's just a suggestion. At the finance meeting on June 27th, I'm sorry, I can't remember the days, council did request various scenarios. The scenarios are the long sheets that were provided in the document. And what I did just to facilitate the discussion amongst council is just put the different options up. The options you will see at the back part of your document, and it's just the totals between the difference between 2018 and 2019 taxation, both by dollar amount as well as percentage. And you have to refer over here to this side for the different classes. So scenario number one, the dollar change, $668,000, and it's a 5.89% increase. Scenario number two, you're putting $150,000 into the reserve funds. You're raising $818,000, and you're increased 7.21%. Now, the percentage of what I'm quoting you is overall. And option number three, you're putting $300,000 into the reserve funds. You're raising $968,000 difference, and your increase overall, 8.53. I'll stop at that point. And you have something to say?
2 points.
Okay.
So just what we wanted to mention was that as far as the education tax rates, we don't set them, the province does. As far as your assessment, we do not set that, MPAC does. So basically, the decision for council, the only thing they can affect are the tax rates. The other thing we wanted to mention is, my understanding is we're trying to get away from dealing in a percentage, because the percentage doesn't mean the same thing to everybody. The other thing is, when people throw out percentages, it's, are you talking tax levy? Are you talking tax rates? There's a lot of interpretation that can happen there. So my understanding was last year there was more of a focus on what is the levy? How much are we asking the ratepayers for? It's that 10 million or 10 million 9, 10 million 8, 10 million 6. So the idea being as well is that there's a 4-year phase in for MPAC. So we, 2019 is the third of the fourth year. So most people, not everybody, their assessment will have gone up anyway. So that's why it's difficult when you're talking the percentages, because even, and I'll point out, so even the example that we had on the sheets, that if a $100,000 home, we used the example of $100,000 for 2018 rates and 2019 rates. Realistically, if your house was $100,000, your assessment last year was that, realistically, it's probably $106,000 this year. So that's why it's very difficult when you're talking the percentages. So in the chart that Wilf had mentioned there, so saying under option one, and the very first line is actually residential, and it says 7.94. Well, probably 6% of that was the increase just for your assessment. So like I say, more the focus that you're asking is the 668,000 or the 818,000 or the 968,000. That's the amount of money extra that's needed in 2019 in order to fund the operating expenses and or the capital tax levy request. And the other thing being too, the assessment does not increase equally across all classes. You've got residential, you've got multi-residential, industrial, commercial. We don't control that. And so that's the other thing too, is you have to watch where the burden is on which class. And some of our average tax ratios are above the provincial averages. So we can't, we're restricted in what we can actually change for some of the tax ratios anyway. So just like I say, to keep in mind that the burden, by using a revenue neutral, they try and have it across all the classes equally in comparison to last year.
On the next three slides, it is, you're looking at your document, it's just the explanation of the houses. As we said to one counselor, really it only works if you think of yourself, well, that's good. Right. It really works if you're considering that you have the only house in the universe and that's the only one being taxed. But it does give you a perception or an idea of what the differences are in terms of a house with a $100,000 assessment, and you see 2018, what your 2019 one is, what's your difference. All I'm going to do is just show the different ones here, and I think it's easier for afterwards when council wants to make a reference back. So again, you see the difference under scenario number two is 78, up from the 45. Under scenario three, you're up at $111 from the 45. And at that point, we stop talking because this is a public presentation and we'll leave it at that. To you, sir.
Thank you, Will. Thank you, Sherry. So I guess now is the time for public comments. First of all, any questions from councillors? A couple of things I'm going to say about public comments. Please be courteous. State your name and your address. Be polite to all parties. And each party may only speak once, and please try to limit your comments to 5 minutes. Okay. Don't all rush. Come on up, Patricia.
Thanks, everybody, for helping me drink my heart dry during the festival, by the way.
You're welcome.
It's Pat McLean. I live at 65A 3rd Street in Kirkland. I was going to bring up some requests as far as the budget goes and as far as our young people here in Kirkland Lake. But by the looks of things, we're going to be staying steady, I guess, and there's not a lot of room for where we want Kirkland Lake to go. What is our mission statement, and where do we want to go? And do we want to be gearing ourselves towards seniors or gearing ourselves towards the young people? But as it states right now, I guess we're trying to just plane out and then begin maybe a year from now or 2 years from now. Do I understand that correct?
I don't think we're aiming at any particular segment of the population, Patricia. I think we're hoping that we can keep the residents, the taxpayers. I'm not sure how many young people own homes and how many seniors, but we're just trying to keep everybody, give them the services they require, right, and try to give our people the tools they require to do what is required by the citizens of Kirkland Lake.
Understood. My only concern, then I'll just stop, is that the young people I'd like to see stay. And I just, that's where the direction is that I'd like to go. And so I understand. And I just wanted to make a point there, because last time at a council meeting, I had asked that the young people, at least some representative from a high school, be able to comment even every 6 months. But that's for another time. I'd just like you guys to keep it in mind, though, as you're trying to plan out as far as the budget goes and that, think about our future residents, you know, the ones coming up. For example, when I was at the skateboard park, I know that there was a request put in for a half pike to be added. I'm just trying to keep the kids somewhere instead of, you know, needing help. And so that's where I'm setting. And when you do decide on the budget, we get planed out, we're where we want to be, maybe remember that. And I'll be back anyway. Okay.
Thanks, Patricia. Anybody else have any comments? Mr. Sorosian.
Danny Sorosian, 93 4th. I have to say one thing. Thank you for everybody's effort to get us to where we are today. The staff, you guys have done lots of work. All this paperwork, Wilf, your staff, thank you very much. I just have a couple of questions and we'll get on with this. Would it be possible for the Works Department to release the breakdown of the cost of the bulldozer to push all the snow away from the bank so they could host the drag races? Two, the $4,000 for gravel for the new downtown parking lot, if it's not broken, this don't fix it. Savings. Three, price of a new 4x4 three-quarter ton truck for waterworks, $47,317. I've been walking by almost every morning with my dog, and there's been four or five trucks that haven't moved in a week. I think we could save that. Four, this might be a bad thing to say, but sign for the complex. If the previous council has made a commitment, why wasn't it in last year's budget? Thank you very much.
Go ahead, Wilf. Oh, okay. I want to say that Danny's been at every meeting, every finance meeting, and every council meeting that I can recall. So he's been here as often as we have. So he's partaked in maybe not the planning, but he's at least been in the audience for every meeting.
I wish you guys all the best. I'm your biggest fan.
Thank you.
I don't have answers for everything. There may be somebody who can help me out.
You don't have to have it today, whenever.
No, if we can settle something, let's settle it now. For preparing for the snow drag race is something we have to come back with, or ballpark thing? Okay, we'll come back with that one.
And I just want to know that, you know, the council has looked at that, Dan. I think you were here for the meeting when we discussed.
Nothing.
Yeah, I know. But we had talked about it here and wondered if it was still worth the effort to put all that extra time and effort of manpower to have a tourist attraction.
Parking lot, whatever is required to bring it up to whatever codes and whatever else is required, we don't want to go over it. A ballpark figure is always given. If we can do it for less, we do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and but once we take responsibility of something or recognize it, our rules change. But we're not here to spend money on parking lots yet.
Yeah.
That's called active living.
I know.
The waterworks trucks, we are still trying to plan in for the future. You may see a truck sitting there a lot of times, perhaps it's just not moving because it can't. I don't know. This is something that has been debated at council, as well as how we're going to pay for it. Looking at lease, ownership, everything like that, they have reduced the number, and I'm sure that if council feels they have to do that, they will give us that direction. It is well heard. Sign for the complex, that is something that has been brought forward. It wasn't done last year because we were working with a partner for a different type of setup. I don't know how to say that without breaking any rules, but it is back in the place now. I agree with people that made a comment that, hey, there's only one complex, you should always be able to find it. Unfortunately, it's when you have visitors, tourists, other games, and that. If you do have a facility, I think you should name it and make it a bit clear. But that is a council decision, and we will take the lead from it.
Thanks, Wolf.
Helen Miller, 44 Balsam Avenue. I'm glad Dan mentioned that parking lot. Like, I don't know why you have to take the ownership, because everybody parks there anyway. And I hate to see money spent on that. I don't see the need, because I've been parking there myself. So. And if you want to walk further, there's the other parking lot.
Thanks, Helen.
Eugene?
Pat.
Can I just make a comment? I want to reinforce what Sherry hit on earlier, and I'll use the number two tax proposal where it says 9.58% increase. That, what Sherry's saying is very true. It could be 9.58, but if your assessment went up more than 6 or 7%, it could be slightly higher than that. Some people's assessments have gone down, very few. On average, I think that it's about a 6.5% increase in the assessment. I think that's fair to say.
For residential.
Yeah, for residential. There are some properties that have gone up more than 6%. They might have been low before. They're catching up. But this is basically the average. Is that a fair comment without getting into the percentage thing?
Yeah, I won't say that it's the average because I didn't calculate that out. I can say this, that's what it works out to be. Because, do you know what I mean? There's so many properties in residential.
Yeah, it's hard to determine. But it could be slightly different from that. Yeah.
Any other comments?
As a previous council member, I've gone through the previous term. I don't think we've ever gone through, well, in that 4 years and what we've done here in the last 6 months working on this budget, and I give Sherry and the senior staff a lot of credit, as Dan Sarosian said. We have gone through this, nitpicked it to death, and it's been very, very thorough. And I think what we're working with now are the accurate numbers from 2018 that we needed to get to where we are today. So I think it's a pretty accurate photo of where we really are and where we need to go. Just that comment. I thank Sherry for her hard work and senior staff. It hasn't been an easy session.
Richard.
Yeah, I just want to say how happy I am to see the number of people that showed up today. And please, don't be shy. This council has never bitten anyone, never attacked anyone, never yelled at anyone that I am aware of, except for maybe Wilf. If you have a question, don't be shy. now's your chance to ask it. We can't possibly know everything about everybody's situation. We can't possibly come up with every idea on what to do with the budget. This is an opportunity that you have, so please, if you have any questions or suggestions, don't be shy. Step up to the mic. Ask them today. That's why we're here.
Fern shy. Anyway, if there are no other comments and no other questions, I guess we'll move for adjournment.
Eugene.
Shari, go ahead.
May I just ask one question?
Sure, you can.
Sorry, you have to come to the
mic. It has to be recorded, Pat.
I'm sorry. I didn't know you were recording this.
The one question, did anybody ever, has Gull Lake ever been brought forward as a taxable or as a property within Kirkland Lake to take advantage of? And I just wanted to ask the question.
You know it's all. Not in Kirkland Lake, eh, for the most part?
No, I, okay,
it's in LaBelle Township.
So you guys said ask a question.
That?
I'm not stupid. Okay, that's fine. I'm done. It was just, I didn't know if you were bringing that in, if anybody had ever brought that into question or anything like that with regards to, you know, you guys accessing it or...
All right. Thanks, Patricia. Any other comments from any of the councillors? I know you've been here for weeks and weeks and weeks talking. This has been, as Pat said, it's been hashed and rehashed and talked about, and we talked about items as small as $200 and items as large as $200,000 or $1 million. So it's been, I know we've worked hard trying to get this budget right. So.
Moved by Councillor Casey Owens, seconded by Councillor Dennis Perrier. The council adjourns its meeting of finance to a regular meeting of council.
All in favor? Passed. We'll have a 5-minute break and then we'll start regular council.
Welcome to the meeting of council of July the 9th, 2019. A couple of notices to read. At its regular meeting of July the 16th, council will consider bylaws to set the 2019 water and wastewater budget and rates, set the 2019 capital and operating budgets, sale of 4 Government Road West and 8 to 10 Callback Avenue, and laneway abutting 69 Federal. Also amending the user fee bylaw, arena floor summer rate to the complex fees. We'll have a moment of silence. Approval of the agenda.
Moved by Councillor Casey Owens, seconded by Councillor Dennis Perrier. The council approves the agenda for its regular meeting held July 9th, 2019, as presented.
All in favor? Unanimous. Any declaration of pecuniary interest? None declared. Petitions and delegations? None declared. Acceptance of minutes and recommendations.
It's moved by Councillor Casey Owens, seconded by Councillor Dennis Perrier. The council accepts the minutes of the following meetings. We have the Tech Centennial Public Library held March 21st, 2019 and May 16th, 2019. The meeting to open sealed quotations for dismantle and removal of the Bailey Bridge held June 18th, 2019. The regular meeting of council held June 18th, 2019. The meeting of finance held June 27th, 2019. The meeting of finance held July 2nd, 2019. And the meeting to open seal quotations for four-wheel drive loader held July 2nd, 2019. And the meeting to open seal quotations for miscellaneous signage held July 2nd, 2019.
All in favor? Unanimous? Reports of municipal officers and communications, acting interim CAO. Wilf?
I'm a very temporary person when you say it like that. The first item on the agenda is actually a proposal from members of the public to set aside, they're asking council for a commitment to set aside a reserve fund that could be used to maintain Kinross Park. Is in the memory of Bill Enoy, our former mayor. The request at this point is just for a commitment that a fund would be set up so that they can proceed with fundraising, and they would bring that back into the to council in the future, obviously.
The resolution is moved by Councillor Casey Owens, seconded by Councillor Dennis Perrier, that council directs the acting chief administrative officer to bring back a bylaw approving the setup of a reserve fund for the purpose of receiving donations in memory of past Mayor Bill Enoy for maintenance and upkeep of the Kinross Trails Park.
Any discussion? All in favor? Unanimous? Passed.
The second item is for the services of or provision of 911 services to continue with the OPP. My document is missing my report. I'm sorry. Yeah, got it. The fire chief has been dealing with this. He is confident that the fee as well as the service exceeds our expectations, and it is the case for most of the municipalities in Ontario. There are some changes. One is just naming. The other one is in terms of the retention of the digital voice recordings for 5 to 7 year period in accordance with OPP policy. We're confident that it's a very professional service that will benefit the community going forward.
Councillor Adams.
So it says option two, direct staff to find alternative providers. So is there other providers of this then?
We did have other services that we had used in this regard, and this really is among the best.
Was that Northern Communications, the previous one?
There were a number that we had looked at.
Okay. Any other comments? Is there a resolution? Or comes back as a bylaw? Thank you. Arena floor space rental?
The final item for myself is the roller derby group has requested the use of the ice surface for training during the summer months. It's not a fee that we have established in our user fees. Bonnie did consider it, and she's recommending that we go with the same fee that we're using for the pavilion at Civic Park, which I think is reasonable given access to it, and it keeps people going between the two. So we're recommending that we add that to the user fees.
They are going to do a presentation to council on the 16th of July as well.
Okay.
So that will be coming back. Yep. Sorry, Rick, Councillor Owens?
Yeah, our rates are usually set based on a cost recovery model. And I don't see any explanation other than it'd be the same as what's used at Civic. I'd like to see an explanation as to how we came up with the $34.80 an hour, and the $26.10 for youth. Otherwise, it's just a figure.
I believe that it was based on what it does cost us for the staff and for the cleaning and that, but I can get that back to you. It's not arbitrary, yes.
I'd like to see that in writing before we make a decision.
Sure.
I think all of council should see that, a justification for that amount. It may be fully justified. It may be low, it may be high, but without it, I don't think we have all the information.
Okay.
Thank you.
Councillor Ivanov.
Yeah, I also agree that, you know, that per hour rate is per person. I mean, if you have three adults there, or if you have 30 adults, it's a big difference, isn't it? $34.80 per hour for adult, is that what that is? That's an hourly?
No, it's for an adult as a class versus youth as a class.
So an hour at the, would be $34.80, it just sounds so inexpensive. Wow.
Not for per person, though.
Well, it's not a per person rate?
Not a per person, it's per the hour.
Still, sounds very inexpensive.
Again, it's, back to the councillor's point, this is what it costs to have the facility, so you're trying to break it, recoup that on that cost.
Wow.
We would
bring it back then.
I assume we would require staffing there.
Yes, you do.
Yeah, one staff is, you gotta be close to that.
Yeah, to your point, it does seem low. Anyway, we will come back with additional.
Just also the staff that was doing other stuff, they're not standing there watching. They are doing other stuff, so it's a portion of their cost per hour.
But okay. They could be standing there watching if there's nothing else to do.
Then we have a bigger problem.
I'd have a resolution. It's moved by Councillor Casey Owen, seconded by Councillor Dennis Perry. The staff bring back a report explaining what the hourly rate entails.
Any further discussion? Councillor Owen?
I'm not sure in the wording there. I think somewhere in there, costs. That's what we're looking for, is the hourly costs.
Okay.
I'd like to see the word costs in there.
We'll amend that slightly.
Okay, so I have it that staff bring back a report explaining what the hourly rate entails and what the actual costs are for the arena floor rental. Okay.
Yep. All in favor?
Unanimous.
Manager of Planning and Land Development, declaration of surplus lots.
Yeah, this one's just pretty quick. We have received some interest in some lots, and in order for me to proceed with any type of report or consideration at council, I need to declare them surplus. So this is just to present a resolution to council for these to be declared surplus and available for purchase.
It's moved by Councillor Dennis Perrier, seconded by Councillor Casey Owens. The council approves the following properties be declared surplus and available for sale. 2 Hilton Avenue, 6 Hilton Avenue, part of 33 Hilton Avenue, 61 Wilson Avenue, and part of lot 94 of M135T.
All in favor? Introduction, reading, and consideration of bylaws.
Moved by Councillor Dennis Perrier, seconded by Councillor Casey Owens, that bylaw 19-063, being a bylaw to authorize mayor and clerk to execute a renewal agreement with the Ontario Provincial Police for 911 primary public safety answering point service, be read a first, second, and third time, enacted and passed.
All in favor?
Unanimous, passed.
Questions from council to staff?
None this
week. None declared. Any notice of motions? None declared. Confirmation bylaw.
It's moved by Councillor Casey Owens, seconded by Councillor Dennis Perrier. that bylaw 19-064, being a bylaw to confirm the proceedings of council at its meeting held July 9th, 2019, be read a first, second, and third time, enacted and passed.
All in favor? Unanimous. Councillors' reports. Councillor Ivanov.
I think we're just coming to the end of what was a 10-day celebration, or I'm not sure. Was Sue here? She was here. I think the anniversary, the committee was just did an amazing job. I think the town was just in awe of what was happening in the community with all the events that were happening. I don't know how the print beer tent went, but aside from that, I think everything else in town was absolutely amazing. The Stope was phenomenal, the downtown, the parade, all the other events that were happening. The festivals committee that did their regular summer events did an amazing job with Blue Rodeo and Serena Ryder. I just want to offer accolades to those people who worked so darn hard. Those volunteers were just amazing. I know I worked with some of them, and they were phenomenal. Everybody had the Kirk Lake in their hearts and in their minds. Just want to thank them all.
I'm sure that same message is echoed from all of council. Sue and your committee did a fantastic job. I'd never thought we would be able to ever match the one that we closed out the old high school, and I've had several people say it equally matched that, so that's quite an accomplishment. So congratulations, and thank you to all your volunteers. I'd also like to thank the Festivals Committee for doing a great job on Canada Day. Was another exceptional day. Really enjoyed and well attended. So thank you to the Festival Committee as well. Councillor Owen?
Yeah, I just wanted to comment on the new bronze sculpture at Tobern Mine Site. If you haven't seen it, go see it. It is a real piece of art. It's added another attraction to Kirkland Lake. And the neat thing is that there's symbols within that sculpture that refer to Rosa Brown, refer to Sir Harry Oakes, and a few other things. So yeah, if you get a chance, make the trip there, because it's certainly an impressive piece of art. And thanks goes to the Tobern Committee and the 100th Anniversary Committee and the Library and Kirkland Lake Gold. And I think those are the main driving forces, the Northern Prospectors Association. But yeah, please make the effort and go see it. You won't be disappointed.
Thank you. Any other comments? Adjournment.
It's moved by Councillor Dennis Perrier, seconded by Councillor Casey Owens. The council adjourns its regular meeting to an in-camera meeting pursuant to Section 239(2) of the Municipal Act to discuss two possible land sales.
All in favor? Unanimous.